Thank you. Christ destroyed our death. In rising, Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, Duane Whitehill put on Christ, and so in Christ may Duane be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of death. Because I live, you shall live also. Friends, we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Duane. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss, and may God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. Family and friends, I'd like to welcome you to the First United Methodist Church of Shenandoah. I am Pastor David Clark, and we are honored to welcome you into this place and to celebrate with you the life of Duane Whitehill. I'm delighted also to partner with Pastor Carl Phillips as we guide us all through this service and celebration of Duane. Welcome to this sacred space together. Let us pray. O God, who gave us birth, you are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Give to us now your grace that as we shrink before the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and of death. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die. And when our days here are accomplished, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in you, and that nothing in life or in death will be able to separate us from your great love in Christ Jesus. We are delighted to have Duane's granddaughter, Sarah, singing for us a couple of selections, and her first song that we'll listen together to is How Great Thou Art.
to share the pulpit with him today, and it's a pleasure to be in this sanctuary and this congregation. Today, as we come together today to honor and celebrate Duane's wife, it's a beautiful fall day outside today. As I look around, I'll all be here, a lot of farmers in here today. And I know that it means a lot to the family that you would pause on Harvest Day to come and spend a couple hours with the family this morning. So let's think about if Duane could be here with us today, what his day would consist of. I imagine he'd probably start out the day by going into the Depot Deli and having coffee with his buddies. Always conversation is always good, and fellowship is always great this time of year. Probably wouldn't stay too long. After all, it's harvest time. Probably would go back home, and if he had some grain in the truck, he'd probably unload that or bring it into town to one of the local elevators. Then he'd go back home. Probably gas up the tractors and the truck and the combine. Everything's got to be ready to go. Probably take one last look at the combine and see if it needed any last minute repairs that he needed to go to town to get parts for. And then he'd think, can I start? Is it ready? Has the dew gone off? As I look at the clock back here, by the time I get done this morning, when we say goodbye to Duane, the dew will be gone and it's time for the combines to roll today. So as I go through this service this morning, I want you to walk with Duane and think about all the conversations that you've had with him, all the advice he's given you. He had a quick wit. You probably laughed a few times along the way. But he was a man that you respected in every sense of the word. I'm not going to try to make you laugh today. I don't think that's what Duane would want. I think he would just ask for your respect one last time. As I go through these scriptures this morning, as I visited with Mindy and Corey the other morning, I already pretty much knew what I wanted to say and what I wanted to use, but then as I visited with them, they just reinforced everything that I wanted to say today. So walk with me and think about Duane in each of these passages. We start out with Psalm 23. It's a psalm of comfort and reassurance. We use it a lot at funerals. It's meant to help the family that comes to say goodbye. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. Yes, he restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Then we transition over into Genesis 2, verse 15. The next three scriptures talk about what it's like to be harvest time and what it means to own a piece of God's earth. The Lord took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and to take care of it. This was man's first occupation on this earth. It must have been a special place in God's heart and mind. The world would not survive without those who raise the crops to provide human existence. We move on to Zechariah. The prophet Zechariah spoke of the land when he said, I'm not a prophet, I'm a farmer, and the land has been my livelihood since my youth. We move on to Matthew 13, verse 44. Jesus tells the disciples a parable. It goes like this: the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has to buy that field. Look at Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Come to me, all of you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. Every one of you in this sanctuary this morning, learn from Duane. For I am gentle and humble in heart. Characterizes Duane. And you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. In John 14, verses 1 through 4, Jesus says, don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, and also trust in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's house. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you when everything is ready? I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am, and you know where I'm going. But then we listen to Proverbs 3, verses 5 through 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all that you do, and he will show you which path to take. The scriptures that I just read are the foundation of Duane's life. Each of you will remember Duane in many different ways. That's what we're here for this morning, is to walk you down memory's lane. So, you might laugh, but most of all, you'll remember. You may shed a tear, and that's just fine. Duane was a wise man, and we have to turn to Ecclesiastes 3:1-8. Solomon talks about words of wisdom and his experiences in his life. And I think you'll see Duane in this passage. For everything, there's a season. A time for every activity under heaven. Yes, a time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant, and yes, a time to harvest. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build up. A time to cry, and yes, a time to laugh. A time to grieve and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather stones. A time to embrace, and a time to turn away. A time to search, and a time to quit searching. A time to keep, and a time to throw away. A time to tear, and a time to mend. A time to be quiet, and a time to speak up. Yes, a time to love, and a time to hate. A time for war, and a time for peace. Duane lived through many of those passages just read. And once again, we turn to Sarah and sing, Only I Can Imagine.
I can only imagine.
will be very, very proud of you. Because that's one of the hardest things you'll ever do in your life is to sing for the, as we say goodbye to the loved one. As I visited with Corey and Mindy the other morning out at Duane's house, it was early in the morning. It was 8 o'clock. Mindy said, well, we could do it at 8. I could have done it at 6:30. Corey needed to go to the field that earlier. But it's happening. And I had to talk with those two. And I couldn't help but think about Duane as we sat there and talked about him, which was appropriate. But also, watch Corey. Corey, you look so much like your granddad, it's remarkable. And your mannerisms are so similar to him. And he contributed to the discussion that we had and the memories that they shared. A lot of memories as we sat there and drank that cup of coffee. But then, as we got ready to leave, or I did, I watched Corey. He went out the door ahead of me, and the first place he went was to the farm truck to get in that truck. It's harvest time. It's time to do things. Mindy and I talked a little bit as he went out the door. Like I said, things need to be done that day. Corey shared a lot of memories with me that morning. Memories that will carry with him and the other family members the rest of their lives. So I invite you, as I go through this part of the service, to think about the memories that you have of Duane. If I ask you to describe Duane, what words would you use? How would you describe your interaction with Duane all the years that you've known him? You'd probably say things like loving husband, father, grandfather, faith-filled Christian, a man who dearly loved his farm and was respected and enjoyed by all. You might have other words you use, and that's just great. He was a man that was well-respected in this community. I think we start out with Duane's commitment to his family he loved so much. He loved to watch his kids participate in their many activities and in sports and other activities, as well as many 4-H activities. And he's carried over to his grandkids as well. And he talks about her experiences in the 4-H. She didn't much like calves, she'd rather have sheep. Calves hurt when you step on your feet. Sheep don't so much. It's okay to laugh. But it's those kind of memories that each of you have, not just with these two I've mentioned, but of all of you in the Whitehill family and all of you in this community. If the memories could talk, we'd be here all day. He was proud of his kids, his grandkids, and their achievements. Duane taught almost all his grandkids how to drive. Can you imagine the experiences and the emotions that went through his mind as we learned to drive? We weren't perfect when we started, but when we got down, we learned what it was all about. As our parents, just like Duane, did for his. He liked to have fun, and he liked his grandkids to have fun as well. Duane could be witty. And I'm sure the morning coffee guys, I'm sure some of you are in here, I just don't know who all of you are, you shared some laughs with Duane. Some that you'll think about right now. Maybe you talked about it this morning when you went to Coffee Down the Depot. Maybe you'll talk about it in the morning. And that's just great. Don't ever let those memories get away from you. Duane never wore matching socks. Maybe you ladies would have noticed that. Us guys wouldn't look to see whether they had matching socks on or not. And I think maybe that became one of Duane's kind of little trademarks there. I understand he had several pairs that didn't match up. And that's fine too. That shows that he was grounded and it was okay for people to laugh once in a while at that little characteristic he had. But as I knew him, he was a very quiet person. But he was one of the kindest and nicest persons that you'd ever want to meet. It must have been the feelings many of you had as I watched you come into this sanctuary to visit with the family this morning. The line was long, and their hearts were respectful. Corey tells me he can be stubborn a little once in a while. I imagine that's crossed over as they've learned to farm together. He thought a lot about how Corey came up and helped him harvest and helped him plant. But we all know that he had a side of him that can be accident prone too. He had some close calls. You might say he had 9 lives. He had had some accidents that probably would have killed most people, but he survived them through the grace of God. He enjoyed raising his livestock, and he was proud of the farm house that he built and invited the neighbors to come over and see it when it was finished. Back in those days, that was a big deal. He was an avid sports fan. He enjoyed the Kansas City Chiefs. Go Chiefs! But as each of you think about Duane's interaction with you, I stopped to think about the times that I interacted with him at the Summit Church. He was a quiet guy. If the church was open when he got there, he went on in. He always sat on the back row in what I call the right-hand corner when you sit at the back of the sanctuary. That was where a lot of the decisions and the conversation were at that congregation on Sunday morning. And he was always in the middle of it. Not very loud, but very respectful, with some very solid thoughts. We covered a lot of subjects then. Farming always headed the list, but then we varied out of conversations and topics as other people came in and sat down in the back row. That's where the men sat, back in the back row for the most part. And we enjoyed those times together, just as you enjoyed the times that you shared with Duane. But as I grew to know him and respect him, I realized there were some things that he didn't talk about too much, but he exhibited every day of his life. His faith was deep. He was concerned about other people besides his family. He was concerned about his neighbors. He was concerned about his church. He was concerned about anybody that he interacted with. That's a pretty good Christian. If I was to describe in my own words, my opinion of Duane, I can say it in 3 words: rock solid individual. There needs to be more of them in the world we live in today, because he was respected by everyone. He had a purpose in his life, and he knew what it was, and that was to raise a family in a Christian home, to be the best farmer that he could be, and to be an active member of this community. And it was all grounded in his belief in God. But maybe I can summarize what I'm saying and you're thinking by this paragraph. But Duane was the happiest and was the most content at his farm on the hill, where he spent countless hours planting and harvesting his crops and raising cattle and hogs. You see, farming was much more than his livelihood. It was his life, his hobby, his purpose, and his calling. So when you walk out of the sanctuary in a few more minutes, you're not saying goodbye to one of God's children. You're saying hello to a way of life that he would encourage each of you to practice. Now he's up there in heaven watching us all today. And God's saying it's okay to rest, Wayne. A job well done and a family well raised. So carry those value systems with you, each and everywhere you go. That's what you take out of this sanctuary today. You practice it every day. Duane was a very sincere individual. We all know that. but sincerity was grounded in his belief in God. Duane Eugene Whitehill was the youngest son of five boys born to Robert Lee and Annie Elizabeth Tyner Whitehill Sr. On June 27, 1931, in Shenandoah, Duane passed away peacefully on Thursday morning, October the 6th, 2022, at his beloved farm with two of his grandsons nearby. Duane's mother, Annie, passed away when Duane was only 3 years of age. His father married Opal Chambers Whitehill, and this union blessed Duane with a stepmother and six siblings. Duane grew up on a farm in rural Page County. While in high school, Duane spent a great deal of time at the home of Roy and Nita Sparks, assisting them with their farm. Duane graduated from Coyne High School in 1949. Shortly after finishing high school, Duane enlisted and served in the United States Army, where he fought in the Korean War. Duane was decorated with medals, including the Korean Service Medal, which was W2BCS, United Nations Service for Korea, Distinguished Unit Citation, and Combat Infantry Badge. Following the war, Duane returned home to live with his Uncle George and Aunt Ruth to assist them on their farm. Then in 1954, Duane married his one true love, Gwyneth Ann Denny. Duane and Gwen moved to the family farm north of Shenandoah, where they raised their four children, Jolene, Rod, Kelly, and Mindy. It was a true family farm. His hard-working, gentle, faith-filled father taught and instilled his children a strong work ethic, a love of God, and the land, as well as commitment to family. While his children were active in school, Duane loved to watch them participate in their many activities, especially sporting events. Duane and Gwen raised their family in some United Methodist Church. Happiest and most content at his farm on that evening, Duane spent countless hours planting and harvesting corn and beans, raising cattle and hogs throughout the years. Farming was so much more than his livelihood. Like I said, it was his hobby, his purpose, his way of life, and his calling. An avid sports fan, Duane especially loved the Kansas City Chiefs. He was the proudest supporter, biggest fan of anything that his grandchildren, great-grandchildren accomplished in their lives. A man with many friends. Some of Duane's closest were those shared one coffee with at the depot, as well as fellow farmers who supported one another through the lean years and celebrated the battle. Duane's sense of humor and love for life and family will forever live on in the hearts of those who were blessed to have been touched by him. Duane is survived by his daughter Mindy, Brian Rice, son-in-law Dan Arndt, six grandchildren, Tim, Sarah Arndt, Tony, Darla Arndt, T.J. Whitehill, Kaylin Whitehill, Kate, Bobby Whitehill, Cora Nicole Rice, four granddaughters, Emily, Corey Miller, Annie, Nathan Klitzing, Aaron Landers Eggerman, and Shelby Tyler Harris. Three brothers, Donald Whitehill, Leroy, Lorraine Whitehill, and Harold Eloise Dinsmore, sister Darlene and Auburn, two brothers-in-law, Jan Marie Denny, Junior Taylor, two sisters-in-law, Ina Ray Whitehill, Debbie Denny, many nieces, nephews, cousins, other relatives, and many friends. Preceded in death by his wife, Gwen Ann Whitehill, daughter Jolene Arndt, two sons, Rodney and Kelly Whitehill, parents Robert and Annie Whitehill, and stepmother Opal Whitehill. Five brothers, Kenneth, Ferris Whitehill, Daryl, Dorothy Whitehill, Boyd, Gwendolyn Whitehill, Jim, Nancy Whitehill, Bob Whitehill, sister Barbara Taylor, four brothers-in-law, Kenneth, Doris Danny, Jim Danny, Joe Danny, and Randy Danny. Now, I'm going to talk to the family. You're all welcome to listen. I'm going back to Philippians 4:8. Duane lived this scripture. I think you'll agree. Whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute. If there's any excellence in any of these things worthy of praise, let your mind dwell on these things. You see, we are where we are today, and we are who we are today, because of those lives who have touched ours, and who have let our lives touch theirs. So yes, our grief is tinged with gratitude today, for lives that have shaped us, for hands that have held us, for voices that have inspired us, for eyes listen to us, believing that those who have died in Christ are risen with Christ. We trust that we'll meet again where there can be no farewells. Thanks be to God. Amen. If you'd like to join along with me in your bulletin, there's a reading entitled The Harvest. It goes like this. Sown in the earth by skillful hands, brought forth by sun and storm, destined for harvest day, fulfilled with ripe grain forms, whole wheat and sheaves prepared for winter that will reign. The story of the life of a man told by the golden grain. Made from earth by loving hands, through heat and rain prepared, the face of joys and storms of life, and treasured moments shared. When at last the harvest comes, as it is doing today, as the fields receive the dew, a life well lived leaves legacy to stay. You see the master's plan is in plain view for all. I invite you to pray. God of love, we thank you for all of which you have blessed us, even to this day. For the gift of joy in days of health and strength, for the gifts of your abiding presence and promise in days of our grief. We praise you for home and friends, for our baptism and a place in your church with all who have faithfully lived and died. Above all else, we thank you for Jesus, who knew our griefs and died our death, and rose for our sake, who lives and prays for us. I invite you to pray the Lord's Prayer using trespasses. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Close with the congregational hymn, Hymn of Promise, number 707.
Service, we are invited with the family to go out to Rose Hill Cemetery for a burial and also military honors out at the graveside. Following that service, you are welcome to join us for lunch downstairs in our fellowship hall. So there's the stairways, probably the better stairways are right out here where you probably came in at. If you need the use of an elevator, I hope you found that the elevator is directly on the side and that goes out to the alleyway, or if you use the basement, that goes down to where the fellowship hall is. So you're welcome to join us for lunch following the services at Rose Hill Cemetery. So thank you for coming and for all of us being here to remember Duane, and I offer this blessing from the words of the Apostle Paul for us here this morning. Now may the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, according to the riches of God's glory, grant you to be strengthened with might through God's Spirit in your inner being, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all of the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Amen.